Hi there, my name is HBS and I'm here to tell you a little story about sickle cell anemia and why I want to join the A team, or should I say the HbA team. Sickle cell anemia is a disease that causes your red blood cells to sickle, or in other words, change shape from a typical biconcave disc to a sickle cell shape, kind of like a crescent moon. Red blood cells are the oxygen transporters in our body, so naturally we need a lot of them. Unfortunately, sickle cells are rigid and sticky, so they worsen blood flow and have a shorter lifespan than normal cells. So, too many sickle cells causes a shortage of red blood cells, resulting in anemia. Normally, your blood looks like this, with no sickle cells. If you have a high number of sickle cells, like this, you have sickle cell anemia. But if your blood looks like this, with some sickle cells, you have the sickle cell trait. To better understand the differences between sickle cell anemia and the sickle cell trait, let's rewind to 1949, where my buddies Linus Pauling, Harvey A. Itano, S.J. Singer, and Ibert C. Wells asked a very important question. To understand their question, let's first consider what they already knew at the time. They knew that sickle cell anemia is hereditary. The commonly accepted hypothesis was that it was an autosomal dominant disease, inherited through a single dominant gene. However, this model of inheritance didn't distinguish the sickle cell trait and sickle cell anemia. They also knew that the sickle cell trait required a larger drop in oxygen partial pressure for cells to sickle compared to sickle cell anemia. This indicated a connection to hemoglobin, the part of red blood cells that binds to oxygen or carbon monoxide. In its bound state, hemoglobin is uniformly distributed in blood cells. But when hemoglobin is unbound, blood cells with the sickle cell trait become sickled because the hemoglobin aggregates and causes the membrane to collapse. So Pauling and his team knew two very important things, which led them to ask, is there any difference in the physical and chemical properties of the hemoglobin in the sickle cell trait, sickle cell anemia, and normal red blood cells? To answer this question, they tested and compared the electrophoretic properties of hemoglobin. They found that hemoglobin from normal red blood cells moved as a negative charge, while hemoglobin from individuals with sickle cell anemia moved as a positive charge. When they tested the hemoglobin from cells with the sickle cell trait, around half the hemoglobin moved as negative charges and the rest as positive charges. This was similar to the results observed in a 50-50 mixture of normal hemoglobin and hemoglobin from people with sickle cell anemia. Basically, they demonstrated that people with sickle cell anemia have different hemoglobin to people with normal cells, and people with the sickle cell trait have an intermediate phenotype, with components from both sickle cell anemia hemoglobin and normal hemoglobin. They proposed that the abnormal hemoglobin in sickle cell anemia was due to mutations in the globin subunits of hemoglobin, which were encoded by genes, and that interactions between abnormal hemoglobin are what cause hemoglobin to aggregate in its unbound state. From their findings, Pauling and his team described sickle cell anemia as a molecular disease and concluded that it's an autosomal recessive disease, not autosomal dominant as suggested by earlier models. Building on Pauling and his team's work, scientists now know that the most common sickle cell anemia is caused by abnormal beta-globin subunits in hemoglobin, resulting from a point mutation in the HBB gene. The HbA allele encodes adult hemoglobin. The HbS allele, that's me, is the mutation that encodes hemoglobin S. If you inherit two copies of me, both beta-globin subunits will be hemoglobin S, so you'll have sickle cell anemia. Inheriting one copy of the HbA allele and one of the HbS allele will give you the sickle cell trait, and two copies of the HbA allele will give you normal hemoglobin. This knowledge has allowed scientists to understand the inheritance of other types of sickle cell disease and research possible treatments. Current research is looking at transplanting bone marrow that produces red blood cells containing normal HbA hemoglobin into individuals with sickle cell anemia, research is also being done on how to fix the defective HBS mutation using gene editing technology. In other words, there's still hope for me. Maybe one day I'll be able to join the HbA team. What a wonderful prospect to end on. I hope you enjoyed this journey through time and learned a little something about sickle cell anemia along the way.